watching CCTV International.
Back in the 1920s, a lot of young Americans enjoyed a romance in literature, travelling to France to pursue their dreams. At this time, Helen Foster, a girl of beauty and talent in her early 20s, made up her mind to come to China, having read reports written by Edgar Snow on this ancient land. Far beyond her expectations, this was a decision that changed her life forever.
Her personal goal in life was to write the best novel that had ever been written. So she set her standards high. And as a writer, she wanted to learn more experiences by seeing other countries. So I think she had a fascination to come to China to see for herself, to learn about another world, to learn about another culture.
She was always dreaming to travel to far places and embark on the road of yellow bricks. So that's why she decided to come to China and to broaden her vision and enrich her life experience so that she could return to the United States and write her great book.
In August 1931, Helen Foster said farewell to her parents and left for Shanghai, the biggest port in China. As soon as she arrived in China, she began to witness how this ancient civilization was humiliated and tortured by Japanese invaders. The homeless were everywhere. Helpless mothers were weeping and hapless children were wailing. Deeply shocked, Foster took many pictures of the sufferings of the Chinese people with the Kodak camera given to her by her mother. Later, many were published in American newspapers. On her second day in Shanghai, Foster arranged to meet and interview Edgar Snow, an American journalist she greatly admired.
Edgar Snow, at that time, was very, very low, period. He was very sick. He had lots of health problems. Also, his thinking was very sad because of what he had seen in China. It was a horrible time in Chinese history, and he took it so personally to his heart.
Helen Snow 到上海的时候呢，艾德加斯诺的情绪已经到了最低点了。他在印度去访问了一回。路上还到这一个驴把他气了一下，还是生气，害得很越级啊，生气，这个情况糟透了。一到上海就听到他母亲去世了，他非常爱他的母亲，说他就在中国不想待一天，他就马上想回去，啊，不愿意再待了。正是这个时候，Helen Snow就到了上海了。到了上海第二天，他就要走。Edgar Snow。
She was interested just to meet him, to learn from him, because he was a journalist. He had written in America. But I think she was really swept off her feet.
So, Edgar Snow, 呢，虽然第一次见面时他迟到了，但是呢，他第一次见到 Helen Snow， 他就，我们可以说一见钟情啊，就。
To see this young, beautiful, enthusiastic woman was a breath of fresh air for him.
Affection was being exchanged in the eyes of Ed and Helen. Edgar said Helen was just like a girl next door. In 1932, the young couple married in a simple wedding.
Helen Snow was one that loved to share ideas. So they went just immediately, head to head, talking about ideas, talking about what happened in China. And once they were married, they constantly shared ideas. Not just what do you see, but what can be done. Let's do it. They were both doers.
他们两个结合成就了他们两个人，如果没有这个可以说没有这个Snow婚姻的话，没有他们这样的一个结合的话，可以说在中国没有爱迪加斯诺，也不可能有一本《西行漫记》。The
marriage was magical, absolutely magical. She had no idea when she came to China that she would meet someone in China to marry.
因为留在中国了，留在东方了，不然的话他就走了。1931年他离开中国了，这《西行记》漫记是1937年出版的，他1936年在山北去采访，所以说这个没有这个婚姻啊，他这个埃德加斯诺要成为一个因为中国革命的问题啊，题材成为一个名记者的话，估计可能是不可能的。
Following their wedding, Edgar and Helen Snow left boisterous Shanghai and settled in Beijing, the ancient capital of China. Employed by Yangtze University as a lecturer in journalism, Edgar converted their courtyard in suburban Peking into a club for foreign journalists and progressive Chinese students. Many of these students later became the cornerstones of the revolution in China. In the process of helping Chinese students to organize events, Edgar and Helen were greatly inspired. They were driven to participate in their cause out of sympathy. Since 1935, they had been writing on the Japanese invasion for the foreign press.
就是那些爱国学生不是到那里去碰头啊聚会啊成了爱国学生的一个碰头的地点和庇护所。On
the 9th of December 1935 in Peking, a patriotic demonstration against the Japanese invasion broke out among students.
学生一些宣言呀，还有一些这个声明啊，还有一些这个口号，标语口号啊。 都是在斯诺家里商量的，也是在那地方翻译的，也是在这地方游印的，而就保存在他们家里。这个游行的路线呢，路线图都是提前预定好的。这斯诺夫妇就把这个路线图啊，就提前告诉他们那个外国记者。In
the spring of 1936, Edgar Snow asked Song Xingling, his old friend, to arrange a visit for him to the Soviet era in northern Shaanxi.
他们两个人呢，对这个认为宋庆龄和鲁迅对他们影响很大。他就说呢，他们两个人，他夫妇两个人就认为啊，宋庆龄呢是东方一朵光辉四射的莲花，是你在东方海岸的一个自由女神。而且他还说呢，鲁迅是教我认识中国的一把钥匙。
36年这个访问陕北啊，也是在这个Helen Snow的这个动作下鼓励一下他，他还有点这个还在这里，他还有点这个犹豫不决，到底去不去？他这个老婆很厉害，说你一定要去啊！这个这是最关键的是世界头号新闻，你必须去。
我们从铁站出来以后，有三道防线要过，第一道呢是陕西的这个边疫，第二道是蓝衣社，第三道啊是什么警察之类的，每一道都挡我们了。Having
broken through all the barricades, Edgar Snow and George Hatton rode to the Soviet area on mules. Snow became the first journalist from the West to enter the Soviet area of northern Shaanxi. Zhou Enlai, the would-be premier of China, drafted a 92-day interview schedule for Snow. Just 3 days after Edgar's arrival, Mao Zedong, the leader of the Communist Party of China, met with Edgar Snow.
他给毛泽东同志，他问拍到给你拍到照片吗？就走到了这个窑洞外面，当时毛主席披着长发，可能是毛泽东同志还像一个儒生，或者是一个诗人，不大像这个号令三军的一个军事啊这个领袖。他灵机一动啊，就把自己的军帽，就他的军帽摘下来，就戴到毛泽东同志头上。
Helen later commented that this picture was simply a masterpiece. It was the most printed and published in the world. So even the classics of the Renaissance could hardly match it. Leaders of the Red Army trusted Edgar Snow as a truth-telling journalist from the West. Mao Zedong and Snow had their interviews in barely decorated cave houses.
也可能是由于毛泽东跟他几天的谈话，毛泽东的个人的魅力，啊，对斯洛产生了影响。他忽然提出了一个问题来，要请毛泽东谈他的个人的历史。这毛泽东同志呢，就否认谈个人自传的必要性。五个是大海当中的一滴嘛，啊，我已经给你介绍了我们党的政策输出的。 斯洛很聪明，他就是采用了一种，就是我们认为是激将法。他说，毛泽东先生呢，外面对你啊有很多传说，啊，有人呢说你是一个无知的农民，有人呢说你是一个会说法语的知识分子，还有人呢说你是一个患肺病半死的人，还有人说你是一个这个狂热分子。 你难道没有必要清除一些这样一些不准确的这种谣传吗？但是毛泽东本来是不想谈，但是这个毛泽东听了他这个话，就感到有点惊讶。那说呢？他说我不知道外人为什么，这么样的兴趣来猜测我本人呢、啊？他说我连国语都说不好。
我还能说法语呀，他说这样吧，我索性就把我的生平简历告诉你。石洛呢，大喜过望，说我要的就是这个。西行漫记啊，它一个很重要的一个部分就是毛泽东的传记，毛泽东的自传，这是那本书的这个还能算叫 spies 这个伎俩，这是最重要的一个部分。如果西行漫记没有这一部分内容的话，那个书啊。
After Snow completed his interviews, Helen decided to go to northern Shaanxi by herself in order to get more news materials. She wanted to see with her own eyes what those so-called red bandits looked like and what kind of life people in that area were leading. At the time, Helen arrived in Xi'an in April 1937. Kuomintang troops and secret agents had already taken control of the complete city. Despite strict surveillance by Kuomintang soldiers, Helen managed to escape through the window of her residence and then set off for northern Shaanxi in secret. Helen put on the uniform of the Red Army as soon as she got into Yan'an. After interviewing dozens of military leaders, she turned to talk to female soldiers about their experiences in the Long March. Her pictures and manuscripts were later added to the Red Star over China. The book was published in October 1937. It was the first to break the decade-long news blackout enforced by the Kuomintang by telling the world about the revolutionary base led by the Communist Party of China.
Especially I got my view of Mao Zedong from Snow because he had talked to him so much. And I read that portion of what became Red Star over China. I read it when it was still in a manuscript form.
1937年3月10号, 毛泽东啊亲自给施洛写了一封，也就是说在他采访不久，不到这个待半年多的时间，毛泽东说，施洛先生自离别后时时念叨你的，你现在量好，我们都感谢你的。毛泽东说了，施洛写了一本真实的反映我们情况的书，
《激情漫记》这本书啊，不是爱德加·斯诺1936年6月至10月那次访问的一个成果，而是两次访问的成果。另外一个就是1937年5月到1937年9月海伦·斯诺的访问，两次访问的成果。为什么这样说呢？很明显，就是当时爱德加·斯诺他这个从来就在那个时候就没见过朱德，当时朱德还没到的陕北呢，他就没采访了朱德。后来呢，关于朱德的那一章啊，就完全是海伦·斯诺采访的。
When Edgar Snow went off to Yan'an, and then he came back with his stories, Helen was a part of helping him to write that book, and then she went to Yan'an and added to that.Meeting many people that Edgar Snow was not able to meet because they weren't there yet. So they blended their knowledge, but they also blended their ideas very, very much so.
Inside Red China was the result of the visit and interviews of Helen Snow in Yan'an. It was almost as good as its predecessor. As the war intensified, Edgar Snow turned himselfinto a battlefield journalist traveling between war scenes. This left Helen alone to shoulder a heavy burden. Conflicts and arguments became more frequent between them.
The long-term product of tensions that had existed really from the very beginning but had become more pronounced in time. And I don't think we can underplay the fact that Ed was really in his glory by this time. He was enjoying great popular acclaim and success. His book, Red Star Over China, had...just hit at that moment, and he was the rising star among the Western reporters. And Helen's book, of course, hadn't given her that same sort of secure, competent foothold in the endeavors that she was engaging in.
Helen Snow returned to the United States in 1940 due to the further widening of the Second World War. She was joined by Edgar Snow 1 year later after he had spent 13 years.Of living as a journalist in China. Filled with regret, Edgar Snow worked hard on their relationship and even bought a cottage in Connecticut. Unfortunately, their relationship was not getting any better under the current environment.
Once they left China, there wasn't that need for each other. They came back to an America.That was very different from their living together. Here in China, they had every day struggles. Struggle for health, struggle for accomplishing their writing, struggle to establish the industrial cooperatives to help China's future. They cared so passionately.That they were just working and working every minute, every day. When they came back, they came against another great wall, the great wall of McCarthyism. That was a horrible time in our history. It was a personal time of defeat for them in their own country. They had been accepted by the Chinese.When they returned, they were not accepted by many of their own people. So they were very sad when they returned to America. And then they began to go their separate ways.
On the 1st of October 1949, Mao Zedong and his colleagues, these so-called Red Bandits, climbed up onto the rostrum of Tiananmen Square,to announce the founding of the People's Republic. In the same year, however, the relationship between this couple that loved China had come to an end. Edgar and Helen Snow, two of the best journalists specializing in the revolution of China, divorced each other.
She was hurt when she returned to the United States because she was called to the White House to attend a kind of hearing, because anybody who had any connections with China, with the communists, have to, what do we say, have to clear, to clarify their connections with China. And she was also hurt by her divorce, although she thought it was very necessary. It was a good thing for them to have a divorce, but at the same time, she felt very hurt.
After the divorce, Edgar Snow married Louise Weller, an American actress. They had to emigrate to Switzerland to escape the persecution and McCarthyism, while Helen Snow retreated to a cottage in Connecticut and began to pursue her dream in creating great literature. During the rest of her life, Helen wrote very many books on China.
All that was important to her was just to write. Material things weren't important to her. When Din Ling, the writer, the famous Chinese writer, came to visit her, Din Ling was very worried that she lived alone. And when she returned to China, she wrote an article about that and felt so sad that Helen didn't have family or someone living with her and taking care like they do here in China. But for Helen, that part was her wish.
No matter where they stayed, Helen and Edgar Snow were always attached to China. They kept talking, writing, and researching about China. In 1960, Edgar Snow broke through the mountains of obstacles to return to China after an absence of 20 years. Back in China, he visited many places, in the cities and in the countryside. He interviewed numerous people from all walks of life, from laborers to the most senior leaders of the country. The China he saw was totally different from the one he lived in from 1928 to 1941. He strongly felt the Red Star was already shining over China. Again, he interviewed his old friend Mao Zedong.
他们两个人有时候一次谈话呀，谈九个小时。毛泽东给他谈了自己内心世界，谈了对国内国外的形势的分析判看法，谈到了个人的忧虑，甚至于谈到了生死问题，真是一种直觉。
他1960年到 中国来一回。哎呀，回去他就给打电话，斯诺给海南打电话，还写信，就说他中国去见到了这个好多老朋友，大家都向你问好。如果你愿意到中国去的话，他们很欢迎你去，等等，说的真好啊。后来呢，他，斯诺不是抽烟抽得很厉害，最后呢，搬到瑞士去以后呢，他就戒烟了，不抽烟了。朱燕他把这个好消息很兴奋，打电话告诉他，那谁呀，你的愿望实现了，我现在终于不抽烟了，戒烟了。
She always talked to me about Edgar Snow and her as one. She never had any bad feelings about Edgar Snow. She never had any regrets about her marriage.
To credit her achievements in literature,The China Writers Association and the China Literature Foundation awarded Helen Snow with the International Literature Prize of Understanding and Friendship.
我第一次到美国接受一个任务，就代表中国作家协会和中华文学基金会去给海伦斯诺颁奖。而且没想到他对中国的感情那么深。我们去的时候，他康克勤大姐给他发了贺信，他 他还保证了他在1937年和康克勤两个人穿着八路军军装那个照片。这个我就觉得他对中国的感情呢，和他应该在不光在脑海里面，是骨髓里血液里这种感情。一个外国人对中国人60年如一日的那种深厚的感情，这个我觉得那这个确实是非常难得的。
On the 1st of October 1970, Mao Zedong invited the American Edgar Snow to join him on the rostrum of Tiananmen Square.
One picture of the two standing side by side on top of the Tiananmen rostrum told the whole world and all the Chinese people that we are friendly to the American people, and if the American administration has a similar idea as the American people with regard to China, we're also ready to establish a good relationship, working relationship with them.
On the 1st of February 1972, President Nixon flew across the Pacific to visit China. The ice began to break between the two great nations that had been hostile towards each other for 2 decades.
This was in 1979 when America and China signed diplomatic relations, and Deng Xiaoping came to America to celebrate. So obviously Helen Snow was invited to this dinner in Washington, D.C. Because she had been with Mao Zedong in 1936 in Yan'an, Mao Zedong had given to her a letter to give to Deng Xiaoping in 1936. But by the time she left Yan'an, Deng Xiaoping had left the front because it was a very dangerous time and the troops had moved on. So she was never able to personally deliver this message from Deng Xiaoping. So at the dinner in Washington, D.C., all these years later, 1979, she met with Deng Xiaoping and said, "Here is a letter."
In the week that changed the world, as President Nixon said in 1972 when he visited China, the physical condition of Edgar Snow began to deteriorate. On the 15th of February 1972, he passed away in Switzerland. In his final days, Edgar Snow wrote shakily in his notebook, with a pen he used for decades, the words, "I love China." He clearly wished that part of himself could remain in China always. In respect, his Chinese friends buried his ashes at Peking University, where he used to teach.
I met with her. She was skin and bone. It's very thin and very weak. And she held my hand in hers and kept talking and asked me to tape our conversation.
Yeah, but Edgar Snow wrote from the outside.
From the outside,
Lu Xun wrote from the inside. And Lu Xun was a critic of the bad condition. Mm. Edgar Snow from the outside wrote the facts as they were.
Yeah.
He described. He was an explorer.
Yeah, that's right.
You use this word, write it down. Explorer.
Explorer, yeah. Explorer.
Edgar Snow was not just a reporter. He explored a new country, a new thinking, right? Mao Zedong was a new thing in the world.
Mm-hmm.
He explored the picture of the communist armies in China and of Mao Zedong, especially Mao Zedong.
Mm-hmm.
In 1997, at the age of 90, Helen Snow died, leaving the cottage that had been her home for decades. She had successfully achieved her literary dream by publishing volumes of books on the Chinese Revolution. She forever cherished her most unforgettable memories, those 10 memorable years in China.